Namadan cembe yanlar gibi çaldan bu. Kaçı çancı işin var çoğundu düde bunca sağdan kalay gün gelci. Dörce dondu dane kolu medarı dan karı çengve çıkar be bak. Zırdılı nambara cüce dolde medo da cen çancı doce zembana çambe tuge bara pamze zobe sange ganye dela göçe çatay güge şenge tele do samdan jorva penzade Çancı tamba tuge tse saya naba çudu yo. Çendan tsücüme lecu işin sıda tsücü gombaraze. Samde şerava Çoğun tambo damba na jiden kebra tamce gang. Dönama şindu toba ge mude çeba tada Tele kige damba ne nime veşin çede na. Namba gündu milu ve zalay kela da kya Künye sonra senge çağlar ciciden çabana. Çandan kelcu gubara gürü laye lama vadrajum. Tuba gami jogadan çansın geba ne cunso. Çaba toba teda gün çüge pamze kela. Kege çançul çonye ne cöve tenzin o zarache. Sebe sele ma cova kuzo dan ve pabu dan. Yege kuzo mi se bala kela pen bala çavu şe. Göme da ca ceso va gombo kela da gelçe. Gave düde duva da mude male pamze da yente loma çame jo gelse da balon dente tece le so tova nam kege yende tenire çancu le do cuba da laryan kela da gelce. Kege sene cambe yan loma şara da bu. Çamba gaza dambra ze simce suje te zomsa. Kege yönde müce ta sege yönde ton Gare şarve sicigi bemü inge vese go. Çedavadan çinye çün kigye namba günye be. Şebe çinle tünşin du cuba kela da ça Tedara cöve lama şageri purama şimbe dungüle çomba. Çomden zobe sange de bayi. Cöve güngin yurdu tobara. Lama dan gombo cedin cambe yanlar gübe çazalım. Kange lödü dinye cinca yedan namdarım sabi. Çinye döngü çişin sice nige tuğla lebanzi. Kanda sibe tırara mari mentumu duma gisirebi. Çozo 주다라 체조 녀모 녀로 레게 자조 조제지 마레 미세 동라 뉴고 진예 주제라제 남 되네 다지 서지 타즈 윤데 류조 갸세 투브고 주다 주다 주니 겐제 다베 미세 자베 양라드 센데 케게 케라와 웨세레게 다베 디모 멤바랍사네 가다 덴주 쇼로 도바이 로드 보베 나와 자도 소 오르게 유게 노자타 베모이 케사라 돈보라 양세 초기 의주니 베모 존에 셰소자 고도 간제 마베 고로이 케기 제소다 주기 신기 탑치 셰소소 구루 베마 시디 오르게 유게 노자자 베마이 케사라 돈보나 얀세 초기 의주니 베마이 주네 셰소자 콜도 칸제 마베 고로이 케기 제소다 주기 신게 남지 셰소소 구루엔 베마 시디 홍홍게 유게 노자 사이 베마이 게사라 돈보라 양젠 초기 의주니 베마이 주네 셰소 콜도 칸제 맘베 고로이 케기 제소 단조게 징게 알랍제 셰소소 구루에 베마 세데
And then on top of that, the ungrateful people and evil people who will show ungratitude will be ungrateful for all of the services that you have done as a bodhisattva for them, and that will sadden you, and therefore you may end up giving the thought of awakening. And so this example, King Bhimasena's example, is mainly about connected with the ingratitude of evil people. So King Bhimasena is actually Shariputra's previous life, one of Shariputra. Shariputra is one of the Buddha's main disciple, the right Buddha's right-hand disciple, the disciple superior in wisdom. So Shariputra, he's mostly depicted on the right side of the Buddha, standing on the right side of the Buddha. So this is Shariputra's past life, one of his past lives when he was known as King Bhimasena. And King Bhimasena was a great bodhisattva.
这里当中就讲到了我们主要是讲了两个有可能会让我们舍弃菩提心的原因，这里面就第一个就是说，有可能因为我们会因为畏惧生老病死的，在长时间在轮回当中受生老病死的痛苦当中而舍弃菩提心，因为之前讲过了，相比起修阿罗汉的果位的话，大乘道的时间会更加的长。第二个有可能我们会因为恶人不感激我们为他们所做的一切，为他们所提供的帮助而使我们伤心，有可能会使我们舍弃菩提心。 这里当中就讲到了一个亟待国王的舍弃菩提心的一个公案，这个亟待的一个国王就是以前经常站在佛陀右手边的舍利子的前世的一个公案。And
King Bhimasena was known to be very benevolent, generous king, and he would usually give many gifts to others, his people, the people living in his kingdom. And then one day, a demon wanted to create obstacles for the king. And so the demon came in a disguise as a person to the king. And he came in the disguise of being an armless person, a person with no arm, without having one arm. And this demon in the disguise of such a person came to the king and asked the king for the king to give him the king's own arm, the right arm of the king. And the king, Bhimasena, being a bodhisattva, having the bodhicitta, the thought of awakening in his mind and great compassion, was willing to give his right arm. So he was very happy when he heard this request, and he was most happy. So he cut his right arm with his left arm. With his left arm, he cut his right arm. And then he needed to to pass the right arm to the demon in disguise. And since he has only one arm now, which is left arm, he held the right arm with his left hand and offered it to the demon. And then the demon became very angered and said, "It is such a disrespectful act to give a gift with your left arm." In India, I think there is a difference with your right arm and left arm. Giving gifts with your right arm is considered respectful, but with giving something with your left arm is disrespectful. I believe it's a tradition in India, ancient India, maybe. So this was all a part of the plan of the demon to discourage the king. And so when the demon said that, then King Bhimasena immediately became very saddened because the demon just said that he wanted his right arm. The king cut it off and gave it to him with his left hand. But then the demon said that it's very disrespectful of you giving me your right arm with your left hand like that. So now I don't want it. So when he said that, the king became very saddened, and he thought that the practice of the bodhisattva is very difficult indeed. And there's no way to please all sentient beings. So I think this is not something that I can do anymore. So I should just give up the practice of the bodhisattva, give up the bodhicitta, thought of awakening. And so he gave up the thought of awakening. So this is the story of King Bhimasena giving up the thought of awakening. Later on, of course, he was reborn in the future as Shariputra and became an arahat. But what we need to know is that he was once somebody called King Bhimasena in his past life, who was a bodhisattva with the bodhicitta, but he gave it up because there were people or sentient beings being ungrateful to him, showing ingratitude to him, even when he was giving, doing such a great deed, a brave deed, such as cutting his arm and giving it to them. Still, there were obstacles like that, so he gave up. And this is something similar that can similarly happen to us. So therefore, we need to be careful of this.
对，他说这个吉代国王的公案就是讲到，吉代国王他是一个非常慷慨的一个国王，他经常会给予别人许许多多的东西。然后有一次，一个恶魔想给吉代国王制造一些委屈，他就化身成了一个没有手臂的人，然后问吉代国王要他的右臂。当然，因为有了升起了菩提心以及大悲心的吉代国王，听到了以后就非常的开心。就毫不犹豫地拿自己的左手砍了自己的右臂，然后因为他的右臂已经被砍了，然后他就用他的左手拿这个右臂去交给这个魔呃这个呃没有手臂的这个魔鬼，但是这个魔鬼他看到了以后就非常的生气，就对他说，用左手给礼物是非常的不礼貌的。当时在古印度有一个传统，就是用左手给礼物是不吉祥、是不礼貌的一种象征。当然，这一切都是这个魔王的计划的一部分，就是为了让这个吉代的国王舍弃菩提心。国王看到了这个魔鬼是这样的反应之后，他感觉到非常的伤心，因为他不但是用听了这根据这个魔鬼所说的砍了自己的右臂，然后把这个右臂就是送给了他，但是这个魔王却说他非常，但是这个魔王却说吉代的国王非常的不礼貌。所以这个国王就感到非常的伤心，觉得菩萨道真的是非常难行持，真的是非常难满足一切众生。当然，所以后来他就舍弃了菩提心。虽然我们后来都知道这个吉代的国王，死后转生成了舍利子，证得阿罗汉的果位。当然，这里我们就是要知道，他是就是舍利子的前世是吉代的国王，然后因为这个魔鬼的，他给出的障碍让他舍弃了菩提心。
You go to the next slide.
我们看下一页。
So as I mentioned earlier, there were two problems: being afraid of having to undergo the birth, old age, sickness, and death for a long time, from lifetime to lifetime, for a very long time, which you do have to go if you are going to be on the Mahayana path. And then there's also the sadness caused due to the people being ungrateful for even if you're doing very good to them and very kind to them. So now these are problems that can occur to us. It's very possible that it will occur to the bodhisattvas and us as practitioners of the Mahayana path. And so what if it does happen, then is there nothing to do about it? And that question may come up. So to answer that, Sapin is saying there are antidotes to these. There is something to do to these, to deal with these problems in case it does arise. So it says here, there are antidotes to this dread. You can dispel it by understanding that these defiling personal aggregates, skanda, are like an illusion. By cultivating the attitude of love towards sentient beings that a parent has toward an only son. And by the discerning wisdom that perceives no difference between an aeon and an instant and realizes that the three times, past, present, and future, are without time. So Sapin, there are two problems. For the antidote to that, there are three solutions, three antidotes to deal with those two problems. And all these three can deal to each of the two problems.
这里我们就是要记得我们之前讲的畏惧轮回过患的舍弃菩提心的两个原因，一个是看到轮回当中生老病死的痛苦，另外一个是被恶人所陷害，也就是说，就算我们对别人非常的好，也有可能也会因为别人的行为或者是他们没有感激的心而使我们伤心。这两点作为我们修菩萨道的修行人来说，都是非常有可能会发生的。那这里有个问题，就是如果这两点发生的话，那我们应该怎么办？是不是就没有办法对治了呢？这里萨迦班智达就给出了三个对治的方法来解决我们所说的这两个问题。接下来会讲的这个三个对治的方法，对于我们之前有可能会舍弃，因为畏惧轮回过患舍弃菩提心的两个细分，都是可以相应而对治的。
So the first antidote is by understanding that these defiling personal aggregates are like an illusion. So defiling personal aggregates we can understand as like our body, and then our feelings, our thoughts, and all of those type. There are five aggregates, but I do not really know the name of them in English, how to say it in English exactly, but we can understand it mainly as our body and then the feelings and the thoughts and the like that we have. So these, if we can understand, right now we see these as all being true. to have a true permanent, not maybe not a permanent, but at times we will, but any, mainly we see all of our body and our thoughts and this to be, to have a true existence. We think it's really there. Of course, this is like when we're not examining the nature of it, when we just in our day-to-day lives, we think that we have a true existing body and all of the feelings and they're all true. There's a nature, a true nature to them. But actually, there is not. And so if we can practice and get used to the thought, get used to thinking and seeing that our body, our thoughts are like an illusion, illusion, which is that it looks like there, it can be very colorful, like the, we can think of it like a rainbow, for example. A rainbow is very colorful, but it doesn't have a true nature. You can put your arm through in the rainbow, but there's nothing to touch. There's nothing there. It just goes away immediately. Yeah, it's there for 1 second. It can be gone in another second. There are many examples for an illusion. And then, of course, there are many when we're in the desert, we can see mirages. When we become very thirsty, those are all like illusions that we see. So we should similarly look at our body and the like as being illusions. If we can see as an illusion, so if we can see it as being similar to an illusion, then we won't be troubled when those thoughts arise.
这里当中我们想 要讲的三个对峙的方法里面，第一个对峙的方法就是把进取运当做一种幻觉。这个进取运也就是指五运，也就是色受想行识，我们的五运。我们现在觉得我们自己的五运就是色受想行识是非常的真实的，但是这是因为我们没有去研究真相。其实我们认为非常真实的进取运就是五运，其实是没有它的实相，都是一种幻觉。举一个经常佛经里面用到的例子，就是像一个彩虹一样，远远的看起来是非常的真实，有很多的非常漂亮的颜色，但是如果靠近它的话却没有实体，手也没有办法触摸到它。或者再举一个例子来说，就好像我们在沙漠里面行走非常口渴的时候，有可能我们会在远方看到海市蜃楼，所以我们的五蕴也是如此，都是像幻觉一样，没有一个真实的存在。所以我们如果产生了之前的两个想法的两个感受，一个是感到轮回生老病死的痛苦，或者是说被恶人所陷害的话，我们也要如此观想，这样的想法也是像幻觉一样。
Usually, all of the suffering comes from a thought, a strong thought that there is a truly existing I. So this all comes from the, based on the body. When we have the body, there is the thought that there is an I because we are able to control this body. So we are the kind of like the host of this body. So we think that based on this body, we believe that there is a truly existing I. And then when we think there is an I or me, then there comes the thought of my this, my that, my friends, my enemies, and such thoughts. And then when there's that, then following that, there comes the attachment to the friends, and then the anger towards or the hatred towards our enemies. And then based on that, we create karma for ourselves, and mostly bad karma. And then from the karma comes the suffering. So that is the connection. So if we see that, if we try to understand that the body itself is like an illusion, it does not truly exist, then that thought that there is an I will not come. It will not appear. And then if there's no thought of an I, then there will not be the thought of my, this, my, that. Then there will not be attachment, no anger. Then there will not be the karma following the attachment and anger. And then if there's no karma, there will be no result, which is suffering, such as the birth, old age, sickness, and death. So this is the connection. So this is the source. If we can see that the aggregates, the body is like an illusion, then the suffering does not result.
所有的痛苦都是来源于我们有一个有一个真实的我的这样的一个想法，然后我们有了一个真实的我的想法，就会让我们就不自觉。 要控制我们自己的身体，因为我们认为有一个真实的我，所以的话，这个想法就会产生了我的什么什么，我的什么什么这样的一个想法。有了这样子的想法的话，我们就会区分于朋友和怨敌，我们就会去执着我们的朋友，去怨恨我们的怨敌。再有了这样的想法之后，我们就会去造业，造了业之后就会受苦。但是我们现在如果明白我们的身体就像幻觉一样的话，那有一个真实的我的想法也不会存在。那这个想法不存在的话，所谓的有我的什么什么，我的什么什么的想法也不会存在，也不会产生我们对朋友的执着，对敌人的怨害。这样子的话，也不会使我们造业，不造业的话，就不会有它的果报，就是受苦。受苦就是我们之前讲的，轮回当中生老病死的痛苦。所以这样子，我们能看，我们再倒推回来看的话，就会明白有一个真实的我想的这个想法。就是所有痛苦的源头，但是如果我们能把这样一个想法和进取运，也就是五蕴一样的来观想，都是幻觉这样的观想的话，就不会有后面一系列的受苦。
And then the second antidote is by cultivating the attitude of love towards sentient beings that a parent has toward an only son or child. We can understand it to the end. So this means that if we are able to cultivate loving kindness in this case means may all sentient beings be endowed with happiness and the causes of happiness. That is love. What loving kindness or love means here. So if we are able to cultivate that thought, that attitude towards sentient beings, and not just think that may all sentient beings, we don't treat sentient beings as being somebody that is unrelated, but we treat them like they are our own child, a parent's own child, because a parent has a lot of love toward their own child, more love than as in that they would have toward a relative or stranger. They have a special love for their own child, the personal child. So likewise, sentient beings like our own child and have a great heart, a loving kindness, then we will not be discouraged when, we will not feel saddened when they are ungrateful to us. Because, for example, a parent may have an ungrateful child. The parent may do a lot of good things for the child, and in return, the child may talk back to the parent, say bad things, disrespect the parent, and the like. But the parent will be able to take it, whatever bad or disrespect the child returns back to the parent. The parent will be able to take all of that because, after all, the child is their own child, their own son or daughter. And it is their responsibility to continue to take care and love them. And so, likewise, if we can have this love towards sentient beings as if they were our own child, then no matter how much they disrespect they show back to us, even when we are doing good things to them, when we are being very kind to them, we will be able to take whatever disrespect they show to us. And so we will not feel saddened.
我们对众生，或者是说对一切有情的话，都应该要产生慈悲心。这里的慈心就是愿一切的有情都能够永居安乐，即安乐因。然后我们看友情的话，要像看我们唯一的子女一样，因为，我们的父母对自己的独子的话，是一种非常特别的爱，和对自己的身边的亲人或者是对陌生人来说都是不一样的。对自己唯一一个孩子的话，是一种非常特殊的这种爱，然后也因为，如果说我们以这样子的想法去看待一切友情的话，有了慈心的加持的话，就不会再感觉到我们在帮助到他人，或者是说为他人服务的时候，别人没有对我们产生感激的心而感到伤心。就好像，父母看他们自己的独生子女的时候，就算父母为独生子女做了一切的话，可是子女还是不听父母的，或者是顶嘴，或者是不尊重父母的话，父母都会接受，因为这是他们唯一的孩子。同样的，我们如果以这样子的方法去关待一切友情的话，我们继续的去关爱他们，去帮助他们，但他们如果就算没有对我们感激的心，或者是对我们产生恶心的话，我们都能够接受。
So, one thing that I would like to point out here is that it shows here on the second antidote, it shows that It is important to cultivate the attitude of love towards sentient beings, or loving kindness. And so this is what it shows. Directly, it shows here that this is the second antidote to the thought of giving up the thought of awakening. Indirectly, what it shows is that if you want to have a very good, stable bodhicitta, a thought of awakening, then you need to practice loving kindness well before that. It's like the cause. But loving kindness is the cause, and bodhicitta is the result. So if you don't practice loving kindness that well in the beginning and go straight to bodhicitta practices, then something similar to what happened to King Bhimasena, that when he was practicing bodhicitta, he gave his right arm to the demon. When the demon didn't accept it, the offering or the gift, then he became saddened and he gave up the bodhicitta easily. And this is because there was a lack of practice of loving kindness. He lacked the practice of loving kindness. So therefore, to have a stable bodhicitta, we need a stable loving kindness along with compassion.
这里法王子想要特别指出了一点的话，就是我们这里讲的第二个对峙的方法当中，就是关修一切有情，应该对母亲对自己的独子一般这样的一个对峙的方法的话，这里当中特别提到的，就是我们升起慈心的重要性。这个升起慈心的重要性，不只是因为它是我们三个对峙，因为恐惧轮回过患而舍弃菩提心的原因，更重要的一点就是这里也间接的说明了。 慈心对于我们升起稳固的菩提心，或者说慈心对我们保有稳固菩提心的重要性。因为如果我们，也就是说我们要先修好慈心的话，才能够修好菩提心。慈心是因，菩提心是果。如果我们在修慈，修菩提心之前不修好慈心的话，就好像我们就也不会有稳固的菩提心。就会像我们前面讲的公案当中的这个吉大的国王一样，因为他 没有稳固的菩提心，他在给予的那个魔王他的右臂了之后，因为魔王没有表现出感激的心，他就会感到非常的伤心，从而放弃了菩提心。所以就是这里也就说明了，如果在菩提心之前，升起菩提心之前没有稳固的慈心加上悲心的话，菩提心也不会稳固。
So then the third antidote here is that it says we should understand that there's no difference between aeon and instant. Instant means like second, the second, like we have hour, minutes, and seconds. So this is like seconds. So if, you know, usually we consider an aeon to be very, very long and an instant or second to be very short, a short period of time. So there's a big difference in what we consider those two to be. And then we also, like, they're all different from each other. That's how we usually consider them to be. But then in this case, Sapin is recommending that when we should also kind of develop this understanding, this wisdom that understands that actually aeon, instant, past, present, and future are all conceptions made by the mind. They're all like labels. Just it's nothing really truly there. There's no such real past, truly existing present, or truly existing future. Those are all names named based on each of their connection. They're dependent on each other. So therefore, there's no true existence. Basically, Sabin is saying that we should understand all of these to be conceptions or labels named by the mind. And in actuality, they are not very different from each other. And so we can understand aeon to be an instant. If we think that the aeon is an instant, then no matter how long time goes, we won't really suffer thinking that all time is going so long, because we are getting used to the thought, we're training ourselves to understand that an aeon is an instant. Basically, the long time is the same as the short time. It's not really different.
这里第三个对峙的方法就是说，我们要了知一了知一个劫和一个刹那当中没有长短之分。我们平时的话，我们都会认为一个阿僧祇劫非常的漫长，一个刹那就是一秒当中非常的短。而且的话，一刹那跟一个劫是不一样的。 当然这是他加班制的，就是要建议我们要升起一种智慧，就是要明白，时间这个概念，不管是一节也好，还是一刹那也好，都是一种标签，都是我们自己的意识当中所升起的一种概念而已。其实没有具体的实体，不管是刹那也好，还是一个节也好，不管是过去、现在、未来、30也好，这些都是互相关带而生，也就是互相依赖而生。也就是说，他们是没有一个具体的实体。这样子的话，也就是说，一个节和一个刹那当中也没有真实的区别。那如果是这样子的话，那如果一个节和一个刹那没有区别的话，那修菩萨道来说，不管花多长的时间，都不是我们概念当中所想的那样非常漫长的时间。也就是说，长的时间也就是短的时间，因为二者没有本质上的区别，因为他们都没有实体。
So if this is still hard to understand, then we can understand it from this example. So this example, I'm just going to make up by myself. I'm bringing it up, something that I thought of. It may work as an example, may not. But basically, usually, you know, when we like we consider this our teaching our class right now, our current teaching class, which would last for about 2 or 3 hours. So, for example, 3 hours. So if you consider the 3 hours to be very long from the very beginning, you're thinking, oh, this class is 3 hours long, and 3 hours is so long, it's going to take forever. Then when you're actually listening to the class, it's going to actually take forever. It's going to seem like the class is going very long because you have first thought that the time, which is the time period, which is 3 hours long, is a very long time period. But in the beginning, if you consider that 3 hours, that you know that the time is very precious, time goes so fast. 3 hours was just going to go like go in an instant. Then, when you listen to the class, it's most likely that you won't feel that it is taking forever, but it is going to actually go. Time is going to go very fast. It's all based on the mind, how you see things, how you understand time to be. So, likewise, if we can understand aeon to be none other than an instant, the same as an instant, the period or the time or duration of an aeon, the duration of an aeon to be the same as the duration of an instant, then we won't feel discouraged, even though the time of practicing the bodhisattva's practices are very long, such as the 3 incalculable aeons.
然后就说他，如果我们觉得之前讲的这个一刹那和一个节当中，其实没有真正的时间的长短，如果这个非常难懂的话，房子他自己想了一个例子，希望能够来帮助我们能够理解。比如说我们现在听课的话，这个比如说我们这一节课会讲了大概3个小时，如果一开始我们在听课之前就想到这节课是3个小时，如果说我们一开始的时候就抱有一种觉得这个课非常的漫长，要讲3个小时，感觉永远都说不完的话，如果我们最开始就抱有这样子的想法来听这节课的话，那确实是会觉得非常的漫长，觉得怎么还没有讲完。但是如果我们最开始听课的时候，我们抱有的想法是觉得时间非常的珍贵，这3个小时一下子就会过去，这节课马上就会讲完了。如果这样子去听这节课的话，确实去一下子3个小时的时间就会过去了。同样，这里就是想要说明，所谓的时间的长短的概念，都是取决于我们的意识，都是取决于我们的意识如何来看待或者是如何来理解时间这个概念。那也就是说，一个节和一个刹那是一样的。那也就是说，一个节和一个刹那，它们的长度来说，其实是一样的。因为都是取决于我们的意识或者是我们的心怎么样去理解，怎么样去看。那如果是这样子的话，我们就不会因为菩萨道非常的漫长，而感到懈怠，而舍弃菩提心。
We can go to the next slide.
我们看下一页。
Also, you will be able to avoid abandoning the thought of awakening by meditating on the religious preceptor and the tutelary deities, and by means of prayers dedicating the roots of virtue. So earlier, there were Sapin mentioned 3 antidotes, but it's not just 3 antidotes. There are more antidotes too that can help. So Sapin is mentioning here some more antidotes. So another way you can avoid such sort of dread of the faults of cyclic existence is by meditating on the religious preceptor and the tutelary deities. So basically, In Tibetan, like Vajrayana, it would be by meditating on your Lama, your Guru, and your Yidam, on your deity. And if it's just perfection vehicle, it would be just your religious preceptor and your deity. Some similar, pretty similar. So if you pray to them and rely on them, they can help you because they can help you to not give up. They are always there supporting you. Your guru and your deities are there supporting you to not give up the thought of awakening. So if you pray to them, that can also help.
除了我们之前讲的三个对峙，有可能会因为畏惧罗跟过患舍弃菩提心的三个对峙的方法之外，这里还有另外一个方法，就是我们通过观修上师本尊回向等的方法来对峙我们有可能会因为畏惧罗跟过患舍弃菩提心。这里的话就是说在金刚乘里面特别强调我们观想上师本尊，祈祷上师本尊的加持，让我们不舍弃菩提心。这样子的话，我们依靠上师本尊的力量的话，也能够帮助我们有可能会因为就会帮助我们远离畏惧轮回过患舍弃菩提心。
And also it says here the dedication and merit, basically prayers dedicating the roots of virtues, dedication and merit. So if you do that, that also helps due to the merit accumulated from that, I believe.
念回向回向善根的话，也能够帮助我们远离舍弃菩提心的原因。如果说我们就是念回向文的话，也能够帮助我们阻止舍弃菩提心。
I think it doesn't sound very connected how dedication and merit helps that, but in my own opinion, it may be because usually if you are somebody that doesn't have much virtue or merit, then you're very vulnerable to harm to receive harm from external forces, your enemies or the demons who do not like the Dharma, who try to create obstacles for you. But if you're somebody that has a lot of merit and virtue, then due to that power, you're not able to be influenced by the obstacles or these evil people or beings that try to create obstacles for you. So maybe that is why. And dedication and merit is considered a great way of accumulating merit, and it saves your merit. It does not make it go to waste. So that is why it's important. And so I believe that when you do that, all of your merit gets saved. And when it gets saved, that keeps you, that makes you stay as a very powerful or virtuous person. And when you're very virtuous, you have some kind of energy which the obstacles cannot harm you. You cannot be influenced by others that try to harm you.
房子说他自己看来这里突然讲到回向善根等，然后就说能够阻止菩提心的舍弃，不是很通顺，或者是说没有再细分的去讲下去。房子认为这里说回向善根的话也能够阻止菩提心的舍弃的一种理解的方法，就是因为有可能我们自己作为修行人来说没有很多的福德，或者是没有很多的功德，那这样子的话我们就会非常的容易受到损害，比如说不管是外在的力量也好，外在的敌人也好，恶魔也好等等，受到各种违缘的伤害。但是如果说我们把我们的善根回向的话，这样子的话就能我们能够积累许许多多的功德，也能够保存我们所行善所积累的福德和善根。这样子的话我们在通过回向的方法的话，就能够保存善根，能够增长我们的功德，这样子的话就会使我们有力量，就不会受外在的损害的影响而舍弃菩提心。
An example of this occurred in the life of the master Dignaga when he was about to abandon the thought of awakening. He was prevented from doing so by his tutelary deity Aryamanjushri. The teacher here should appropriately elaborate about those things in more detail. So there's an example of how the tutelary deities help the practitioners in times of need. And the example is of the story from Master Dignaga, who is an Indian master. And he was helped by Aryamanjushri. He was about to give up his thought of awakening when Aryamanjushri came in to help him and to encourage him to continue practicing the thought of awakening and not give it up. And so here it says, Sabin is recommending that the teacher who is teaching this book, clarifying the sage's intent, should speak of other stories, should speak in detail about the story of Dignaga and of other stories if there are time. But there's not really time to speak of other stories. So I'll speak of the story of Dignaga in some detail.
比如说，当时在阿舍利陈那想要舍弃菩提心的时候，是他的本尊文殊菩萨阻止了他。陈那就是印度的一个论师，当他当时要舍弃菩提心的时候，受文殊菩萨的帮助，他就没有舍弃了菩提心。萨迦班智达建议这里在，在这里所展述，牟尼密显明论的老师当中去展开说这个公案，或者是说其他的公案。那法子说我们没有时间讲其他的公案，但是可以把这个公案说一下。
So basically, Dignaga was born as the son of a king in South India, and so he was born to the son of a king in South India, and from a young age he left the kingdom and became a monk.
陈那当时是在南印度一个国王的一个国王的儿子，就是一个王子。他当时他当时离开了国王去出家。
And when he became a monk, he took his ordination vows, his monk's vows, from a teacher of the Hinayana tradition. And this Hinayana teacher spoke of there being an I or me, a truly existing I, or self, you could say a self, a truly existing self. And this is quite rare because most of the Buddhist traditions deny the existence of a self. But there was this one Hinayana tradition that spoke of the self, and Dignaga, when he went to receive his ordination vows, happened to receive it from the teacher belonging to that Buddhist sect, the sect or tradition that taught that there was a self, there was a true existing self.
当时陈大俊所修持的是，是小乘的佛教，然后他当时所去修行的这些佛教当中，他有一个传承，就是或者就是认为有一个所谓的我的一个观念。当然这是非常的奇怪以及非常稀有的，因为佛教当中都是说是无我的观念，在当时陈大所去修持的那个教派当中，就是坚持有一个我的这样的观念。
You know, this teaching of being a self and not being a self is very important because this is a very, this has an important point to understand from this, because usually if there's a self, if you have a strong thought that there is a self, and as I mentioned earlier, that you have the thought of there being my friends, my this, my that, my friends, my enemies, from that, and there will be the thought of attachment, anger, actions, then there'll be results of suffering, the like. So it becomes this thought of there being a self is the cause of samsara. As long as you have this thought that there is a self, then you will be stuck in samsara. If you are able to give up the thought that there is a self, if you are able to understand that there is no self, no truly existing self, no self, then you will be free from samsara eventually. So therefore, this is an important topic.
有我和无我这个观念非常的重要。如果我们有坚持一个有我的这样的观念的话，就会产生我的朋友、我的敌人这样子的想法。因为这个想法就会产生所谓我们就会产生执着和产生怨恨啊、因为这样子的话就会使我们造业，造业的话就会受果。也就是说有我这样的一个观念是让我们是产生轮回的因，也就是说有了这样子的一个有我的这样的一个我执这样子的观念的话，就会使我们在轮回当中流转。如果是通过无我这样的观念的话去用无我的观念去思考的话，就会使我们从轮回当中摆脱出来。
So, as I mentioned, the thought of there being a self is the cause for samsara. And the thought of there being no self is the cause for liberation.
梵王子说, 就像我刚才讲到的, 有我这样的观点是制造轮回的因, 而无我这样的观点是使我们远离轮回的因。
But when Dignaga took his ordination vows, he met with the teacher that taught that there was a self. And due to that, Dignaga, who was a very smart kind of a person with high faculties, a very smart person, became very uncomfortable with that teaching that there was a self. It just, he was not very comfortable with that. And due to that, he went into his room. He opened four windows. It seems he had windows on four sides of the room. So in the four directions of his room, he had each window on each side. So he opened all of them in the daytime. At nighttime, he would burn candles in the room. And he would take off all of his clothes and look at himself and search for a self, just as his teacher was speaking of there being a self. He tried to search if where is the self that my teacher is speaking of.
当时陈娜在说了出家戒的时候，由于他的智慧非常的过人，就算当时他学的那个法脉当中坚持一个有我的观念的话，由于他过人的智慧，他总觉得这观念非常的不对，总觉得哪里有什么奇怪的地方，所以他后来他在回到他自己的家中的时候，他就在白天的时候他会打开他房间里的四扇窗，然后在晚上的时候他会点上蜡烛，然后把自己的衣服都脱掉，然后静静的思考他的老师和他说的这个我的观念到底是什么样的方式存在，到底哪里有一个我。
And when his teacher noticed that he was doing such things, his teacher went to him and said, "You are a monk, and taking off all of your clothes and doing strange actions, having this strange behavior is not appropriate. As a monk, you should be wearing your clothes, you should do meditation and follow the moral conduct and all that. So this, what you're doing is inappropriate." And in reply to that, Dignaga told his teacher that, "Teacher, you have been speaking about there being a self, but you speak of such a self, but I cannot find the self within me. So because I couldn't find a self, I want to find it. So I opened, when I'm in my room, I opened my windows so there could be light coming in the room. And maybe that would reveal the self, but still I couldn't find it. So for there to be extra light in the room, so maybe I could possibly find the self, I burnt some candles. I lighted some candles. And with all of that light in the room, I still couldn't find the self. So I took off my clothes and then still searched for the self and I couldn't find the self. So there must, and I, so even after all of this inspection, I cannot find the self. So maybe there is no self." And so he told his teacher that.
那他的老师意识到陈娜在这样子行持的时候，就和他说这样做是不对的。作为出家人来说，不能把自己的衣服都脱掉，应该要去守戒、去修行等等。但是陈娜回答他的老师说：“您总说有一个我这样子的一个存在，但是我怎么样找都找不到这个我。我想找到这样子的一个我，所以我把窗打开，能够让光进来。可是我找不到所谓的我。然后我想，有可能是因为光线不够。” 我就会把蜡烛点上了，这样想可以找到一个我。可是我还是找不到这样子的一个我，于是我把衣服都脱了，还是都找不到一个这样所谓的我，因为我非常想要找到老师所说的这个所谓的我，可是还是找不到，所以认为没有一个我的这样的存在。
So when he told that to his teacher, his teacher said, "Oh, that is not right. If there is no self, then there would be no karma, no causes and results, no karma. Karmic cycle, no karma. And so that doesn't make sense. Since you do not accept there to be a self, you are a nihilist." So his teacher said, "You are a nihilist." And he then expelled his student from the monastery. He kicked out his student Dignaga and sent him away.
这个老师就回答这个陈娜说，他这样子的想法是不对的，就是认为没有一个我存在这样想法是不对的，因为只有我这样子的一个观念的话，才能够就是或者是说，如果没有我的话，也就没有所谓的造业，也就没有所谓的轮回。这样子的话，他就说陈娜是一个虚无主义者，所以就说他这样子的观念是不对的。
And so after that, Dignaga went on and he found a cave and he entered the cave and made it his home, or kind of like a temporary home, place to stay. And in there, he wrote texts, he wrote some scriptures, some short scriptures on the subject of valid cognition. Brahmana in Sanskrit, in English, it would be valid cognition. And so he did that, and eventually he thought of writing a major text on the subject of valid cognition. So he wrote some stanzas on the board that he had in the cave. He wrote some stanzas to start with at the beginning of the text on the board, and then he left it there and he went out of his cave for like a walk. Or maybe to just find some food.
之后，陈娜就找到了一个山洞，作为她临时居住的一个地方。然后在这个洞穴里面，她就写了一个寄送，就是我们可以把它翻译为证件的这样的一些她的一些想法和一些寄送。然后她也在这个洞的这个岩石上面写了一些偈子。然后她写完这些偈子之后，她就出去觅食。
And at that time, there was a Hindu, I believe, a Hindu practitioner, or you could understand this in Helvetic. So there was such a practitioner who had cleverness, so he could understand the thoughts or minds of other people. And he understood that there was a monk called Dignaga in that cave who was going to write a text, major text, a Buddhist text, a scripture. And he understood that if Dignaga completed the scripture, that Buddhist scripture would rise to fame, it would become very famous, and it would help in flourishing the Buddhist tradition. And if that happens, that would harm the Hindu, his own tradition, the practitioner's own religion. So he thought that I should make sure that Dignaga cannot complete his. Cannot complete writing his scripture. So he went into the cave while Dignaga was out and he would erase what Dignaga wrote. And then Dignaga came back and found that when he came back to his cave, he found that it was erased. And then he would write it again, what he had wrote earlier. And then he would go out and then the heretic would go in, erase it again. And that happened several times until Dignaga came back. In the end, Dignaga wrote on the board that he would write the scripture on. He wrote that whoever it is that is erasing what I'm writing, don't continue erasing it. Stay here and let's have discussions. Just wait here and we can have discussions. So don't keep on erasing what I'm writing. And he invited the heretic to stay so they could have discussions and have a debate, a challenge.
当时有一个印度的一个外教，他当时有个印度的一个外道的一个信徒，因为他有他心通，所以他知道这里有一个修行人，他会写一些偈颂，然后他写完这些偈颂的话，就会使佛教兴盛，这样子的话就会使他们的外道受到影响，所以这个外道徒他就想要去阻碍陈娜把这个偈颂全部写完，所以他每次等到陈娜出去的时候，就出去觅食的时候，他就会到这个岩洞里面把陈娜所写的偈颂全部都擦掉，然后陈娜回来之后又会看到这些偈颂被擦掉之后，他又会重新写。写完之后，他又出去了。出去之后，那外道徒又会进来，又把他之前写的东西又会擦掉。这样子， 反复了多次之后，就是陈娜写完之后又被他擦掉，擦掉之后又继续写。之后陈娜有一次回到这个洞穴里的时候，就在他写的这个板上写啊，不要再把我写的东西擦掉了啊，不管是谁啊，请你留在这个地方，我们来进行一场辩论。可是不要再把我写的东西擦掉了。
And the heretic accepted the challenge, and then they met together in his cave, Dignaga's cave, and they held a debate. And they had, as in times of past in India, whenever a Buddhist and a non-Buddhist proponent came into debate, they would always, in most cases, make a promise that whoever loses, whoever wins, the loser will convert to the winner's religion. So if Dignaga wins, the heretic needs to convert to Buddhism. If the heretic wins, Dignaga needs to convert to his religion. So they made such a promise and they debated.
当时那个印度的外教，他，印度的外道徒，他就接受了陈娜的这个辩论的这个邀请。当时古印度有一个传统，就不管是佛教徒啊，还是其他的教徒也好，只要是和外道辩论的话，当时的规定就是输的那个人就会要转变他们的信仰，就是说输了那个人要接受赢了那场辩论的人的宗教信仰。
And the heretic held his stance by saying that sentient beings have on the stage of a sentient beings have the Buddhahood that is complete with all of the great qualities. So that was his stance. What probably that means is that he said that sentient beings have all of the qualities of a Buddha already, fully endowed with all of the qualities of a Buddha. And that is not something that Buddhists agree with. We do say that sentient beings have Buddha nature, the potential to attain Buddhahood, but we don't say that sentient beings are already a Buddha right now and have all of the marks of a Buddha or all of the signs or the powers of a Buddha already. That is something that needs to be cultivated through practice, and then eventually you can attain. But he said, this heretic said that sentient beings have that from the very beginning, already have all of the qualities of a Buddha. And so Dignaga debated with him, and Dignaga won. The heretic was not able to hold on to his stance.
当时这个外道徒他认为一切有情，因为都具有佛性的原因，所以他们都包含了所有佛的功德。但是这个观点其实是对于佛教徒来说是不对的，因为确实一切有情都是有佛性，但是我们作为有情来说，还不能说我们就已经是佛，还不能说我们就已经完全具备了佛的功德，比如说佛的相好庄严等等。都是这些都是要通过修行，通过我们的行持才能够升起佛的功德，所以当时陈南就赢了那个外道论师。
And after he lost to Dignaga, he was supposed to keep his promise and convert to Buddhism, as they had promised earlier, as they had come to agreement earlier. But he did not do that, and instead he thought, well, if I convert to Buddhism, it seems that this heretic was one of the most well-known teachers of his own religion at that time. So that means he had a lot of followers. And so if he converted to Dignaga's tradition, then that would become famous, that news would spread, and all of his followers would also eventually convert. And then that would hurt his own religion in the end. So he thought, I still can never convert to Dignaga's religion. So instead of converting, he had powers. He had magical powers. So he breathed he was able to breathe fire. So he blew out some fire from his mouth. It was some kind of magical powers, which was blowing out fire from his mouth. And when the heretic did that, all of the trees, the forests surrounding the Dignaga's cave burnt. went on fire, came on fire, and burnt. And even because the Naga himself was somebody that was endowed with the thought of awakening, because he had bodhicitta, the fire was not able to hurt him, but the fire still burnt all of Dignaga's hair and his beard and mustache.
现在之前乐队好，辩论的输掉的那一个人要守持诺言，要转变去相去，要转变自己的信仰，也就是说，当时那个外道他本来应该要守持诺言来，之后就转变成佛教徒，但是那个外道他当时没有守持自己的诺言，因为他。 他用那个外道徒，在他自己的教派当中是一个非常德高望重的一个老师，他有许许多多的跟随者。他当时就想，如果他就因此而转变成了佛教徒的话，那他所有的信徒、所有跟随他的人也会因此而转变成佛教徒。这样子的话，就会伤害他自己所修持的那个教派，因此他就不能转变成佛教徒。 因为他自己具有神通，他其中的一个神通就是他能够从嘴里喷火，所以他当时就利用这个神通，就嘴巴当中喷出了许许多多火，然后把周围的树木都烧尽了。但是因为陈娜她具有菩提心，因为菩提心的力量，这个火焰没有能够烧及到她，但这个火焰还是烧到了陈娜的头发以及胡子。
So Dignaga then thought, actually, what I just did for him was, I actually helped this heretic by debating with him. I showed him that his views were wrong. I introduced him to the right views, the correct views. I introduced him to correct path, practice to practicing and progressing. But instead, even after I did all of this, actually, I did a great service by doing this for him, but the heretic in return breathed fire on me and tried to hurt me. So he thought that now this is becoming very difficult. I wonder if I can really continue with helping sentient beings. So Dignaga thought of giving up the thought of awakening.
陈娜当时想，我刚刚这一些所做的这一切都是为了能够帮助这个外道，能够帮助他远离邪见，能够让他拥有正见，能够使他有进步。但是我为他做的这一切的话，他却想要喷火，想要伤害我。陈娜就想，确实帮助众生是非常的难，到底能不能够因此而帮助到众生？
And he had this writing board, a board to write his scripture. So he held that and he made a promise that he thought to himself, I will throw this board up in the air. And when it, at the moment it falls down onto the ground, I'll throw it up in the air. And the moment the board falls down to the ground, at that same moment, I will give up my thought of awakening. So he thought of that to himself and he threw the board up into the air.
陈娜当时就想，他打算把自己的这个写论点的这个板扔到空中。他想到，等到这个白板，等到他写论点的这个板落到地上的时候，他就放弃菩提心。
And then he threw it up and then waited for it to fall down. And he waited for a long time, but the board did not fall down. And eventually he looked up into the sky and he saw Arya Manjushri up in the sky, holding the board up.
他把这个板扔上去了之后，等了很长的时间都还是没有看到这个板落下来。于是陈娜就抬头一看，就看到的是文殊菩萨接住了他所扔上去的这个板。And
then when he saw Arya Manjushri, Dignaga told, informed Arya Manjushri, sentient beings have immense suffering, and it is very difficult to meet great beings in one's lifetime. But today I have met you, Arya Manjushri. I'm seeing you today, finally. So if you do not bless me right now, this meeting with you will go in vain. So you must bless me. And so he informed, requested Manjushri for that, in that way. And in reply, Manjushri said, if you continue writing your scripture, it will benefit the doctrine and sentient beings. So continue, please continue writing that and don't give up. And I, Aryamajishri, am your teacher, and I will always be here to support you. So do not give up on your thought of awakening as well. So then Dignaga, after being comforted by Manjushri like that, continued writing the book. He did not give up his bodhicitta thought of awakening. And eventually that book came to be known as the Compendium of Valid Cognition. And it became a famous text studied by many Buddhists, and it benefited the Buddha Dharma.
所以他当时就告诉了文殊菩萨，说觉得有情有绪，许多的痛苦，但是他之前通过他的方法来帮助有情的话，也没能够达到他想他希望得到的结果。文殊菩萨就告诉他说，就让陈那继续写他的这个论点，然后继续能够帮助众生，因为他写的这个论点的话，以后就能够利益到无量的众生。 在此期间，文殊菩萨也会作为他的老师，会一直加持文殊菩萨，会一直加持陈那。当时陈那听了文殊菩萨所说，就受到了非常大的慰藉。之后，他就没有舍弃他的菩提心，就继续把他的这个偈颂写完。之后，这个偈颂就成了许多佛教徒都受益的一个论点。简单翻译的来说，可以就说是一个正见的这样的一个论点。
So likewise, if we can rely on our deities, we all have our own deities, or if we do not know who our deity is, of course, there are many Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, each of us have a special liking. We all feel a special connection with one of them, one particular Bodhisattva. Some feel a connection with Guru Rinpoche, some feel one with Tara, or with other deities, or Amitabha and the like. So we just need to rely on them, whoever we feel a strong connection to. And whenever we feel saddened and close to feeling like we might give up the thought of awakening, or feeling discouraged or faint-hearted or any kind of, whenever we're feeling down, basically, if we rely on them, pray to them, and remind ourselves that we have their support and they are always there for to help us, then that can kind of like help boost our confidence, refreshen our minds, inspire us to continue with our practice and not giving up the thought of awakening.
所以我们就是要依靠本尊的加持，不管是我们的本尊是莲花生大师，还是杜母，还是阿弥陀佛。当我们感到伤心、感到懈怠，想要放弃菩提心的时候，不管是因为恐惧轮回过患，还是因为恐惧心等等，想要放弃菩提心的时候，我们都要依靠本尊的加持，要一直相信本尊一直会在那里帮助我们，只要我们用心去祈祷的话。这样子的话，就能够激励我们的修行。还要补充说一点，之前陈大所翻译所写的那个论点是极量论。
We can go to the next slide. So with that, we have completed the explanation of the training in medium detail. So now we are going to speak of the training, the explanation of the training in great detail.
以上我们就讲完了愿菩提心当中的就是比较就是愿菩提心当中简说的一些学处，接下来我们要说广义的学处。This
has three main topics: the causes for the thought of awakening to arise, the conditions that cause its increase, and the methods for keeping it from declining.
这里广义的学处有三个细分，一个是升起菩提心的因，一个是增长菩提心的缘，还有一个就是菩提心不退失的方法。So
what it's going to speak here is the first, the causes for the thought of awakening. So Sabin is going to introduce us what causes the thought of awakening. So if we don't have the thought of awakening, we need to cultivate it. We need it to arise in our minds. But nothing arises without its cause. So for the thought of awakening to arise, it also has its causes. And if there are the causes, then there's going to be the result, which is the thought of awakening. So we need to know what are the causes, what makes the thought of awakening be born in our minds, what makes it arise in our minds. So Sabin is going to speak with that.
这里蔡加班智达要讲的就是要升起菩提心的因，因为我们现在不具有菩提心，所以的话我们就是要先要找到啊，或者先要明白什么是升起菩提心的因，有了因就会有果啊，果就是菩提心，所以这里蔡加班智达就是讲了升起菩提心的因具体是什么。
The second is the conditions that causes its increase. So after we understand the causes for the thought of awakening, and we practice that, then the thought of awakening will be born in our mind.Once it's born, that alone is not enough. We need to keep it. We need to maintain the thought of awakening in our minds. And the thought of awakening may, once we, not just maintain, but we need it to increase, we need it to make it become stronger and stable and stronger. So in order to do that, we need to know what are the conditions that help it to increase, to make it more powerful. So Sapan will introduce that as well.
第二个就是说要明白增长菩提心的源是什么。我们在升起了菩提心之后的话，还要使我们的菩提心稳固，要增上我们的菩提心。要做到这一点的话，就是要通过助缘。所以这里大家还会讲到，是我们菩提心增长的一个助缘是什么。
The third is the methods for keeping it from declining. So once we have it, it is also due to obstacles. It may decline. It may get poor and poor and poor eventually.Instead of getting better, it makes him worse. And the thought gets weaker and weaker, and eventually until we give up the thought of awakening. So that's something that should not happen. We should not let it happen. So in order to avoid that from happening, we need to rely on some methods which will help us from avoiding that situation. So Sapan will introduce to us that the methods as well.
第三个就是讲不退失菩提心的方法，就是说我们在升起了菩提心之后的话，有可能会碰到种种的障碍，使我们的菩提心削弱，之后有可能会放弃菩提心，避免这一切的发生的时候，避免这一切的发生，现在班智达这里也会讲，我们要依靠什么样的方法来使我们的菩提心不退失。
So first is the causes for the aspiring thought of awakening to arise.The thought of awakening arises from compassion, which desires that you and others be free of suffering, and from loving kindness, which desires that you and others attain happiness. So if you want to know what the cause of thought of awakening is, from what does the thought of awakening, from what is the bodhicitta born from? Then the answer is, it is loving kindness and compassion. So compassion is the thoughtthat may all sentient beings be free from suffering and the causes of suffering. And loving kindness is, may all sentient beings be endowed with happiness and the causes of happiness. And if you have these two thoughts, then the thought of awakening will be born.
第一个说的是升起菩提心的因，那就是菩提心由什么而生？这里就是说菩提心是由慈心和悲心而生。悲心的话就是希望一切众生都能够远离痛苦以及痛苦的因，慈心就是说希望一切众生都能够永居安乐以及安乐的因。
We can go to the next slide.
我们看下一页。
Therefore, you must exert yourself in the cultivation of those two.As it is said in the ornament of Mahayana Sutras, compassion's moisture is loving kindness, and it is perfect, and it perfectly arises from suffering. So, if we want the thought of awakening to be born in our mind, we need to exert ourselves in the cultivation of those two. Those two are the loving kindness and compassion. We need to cultivate those two. We need to practice those two for a period and make them become very stable. And if those two are stable, then we will have a stable bodhicitta.
这里当中就像庄严经论当中所讲到的，悲心之根是慈心，清净生于痛苦中。这里就是说，我们要升起菩提心之前，首先就是要修持慈悲心，在慈悲心稳固的时候，就能够帮助我们升起菩提心。
And Sabin is quoting the Ornament of Mahayana Sutras, which is a textbook. it's the textbook, as if you remember, that this Clarifying the Sage's Intent book is based upon. So this book is based upon that sutra. It's not a sutra, but it's a scripture, a Mahayana scripture, ornament of Mahayana sutras. So the quote is, compassion's moisture is loving kindness, and it perfectly arises from suffering. So what that means is that the cause of compassion is loving kindness. From loving kindness comes compassion. Compassion is like the water or the moisture, and loving kindness is like the source for the water to come out from. And where does compassion itself, how does compassion arise from? What does it arise from? Not just from loving kindness, but it also arises from understanding the suffering of sentient beings.
这里所引用的经典就是大乘经庄严论，就是我们整个摩尼密行明论的基础的一个论点，就是一个大乘的一个论点。这里这个偈颂当中的前半句就是悲心，这个是慈心里面的意思，就是说悲心是由慈心而升起的，因为慈心当中能够产生悲心，也就是慈心是产生悲心的一个源头，悲心的产生也是因为看到众生的受苦而产生。Sorry,
I explained half of the quote wrongly. So the first is, as I mentioned, compassion's moisture is loving kindness. So compassion is like the moisture of water. Its source is loving kindness. So loving kindness is like the source for the water to come out from. That is correct. That is the same. And it perfectly arises from suffering. So the way to explain that is, so compassion, as I mentioned earlier, compassion's source is loving kindness. Where does loving kindness, what is loving kindness source? What is the source of loving kindness itself? So you just need to connect it. Compassion's source is loving kindness. Then what is the source of loving kindness? Loving kindness is born by wishing, by understanding the suffering of sentient beings and wishing that they, instead of them experiencing suffering, may they experience happiness.
悲心的升起是由慈心的基础，那不是说悲心的源头是什么，是说那慈心的源头是什么。慈心的源头就是说我们因为理解众生一切有情，他们所受的苦，由于这一点而升起慈心，希望他们能够远离他们这一切，因为我们的慈心是因为理解众生的苦，然后希望他们都能够具有安乐的因，这样子就能够产生慈心。
I think it's better to explain it this way. Loving kindness is born from the thought of wanting to save sentient beings from suffering. So it's better to explain that way. So compassion is like the moisture, its source is loving kindness. And loving kindness itself is born from the thought of wishing to save sentient beings from suffering. So let's explain it that way.
然后是更好的一个解释，就是说，慈心是由于想要救度众生远离痛苦的这样子的一个发心而产生的慈心。那悲心的话，由慈心而生，也就是说，悲心的源泉是由于慈心，也就是想我们想要救度众生远离痛苦这样的一个心愿是慈心。
So these days, the internet here in India is a little bit poor. I don't know why the signal, the connection has become quite poor. I don't know if it's the tower, the problem of the towers, I don't know. So I might get cut off if I speak too long. So I think maybe I'll leave it here for today, and then we'll continue with one of the verses from the 37 practice of Bodhisattva.
刚刚说这两天印度的网络非常不好，信号非常的不好，不知道是不是外面信号塔的原因，所以就怕讲了太多之后的话，有可能之后信号就断了。那我们今天王一鸣写名字就讲到这里，我们接下来讲佛子行三十七颂。
那么达拉贝拉来查查罗，给做爱学的用所说吧，来在坦博古耶的布也别振作来做了老多，在长久三年穷别我可拉去。都叫临时不能那么就他也现在苦给忙了，托起前边高登给把，开把普陀中为原点你。你这别个了，千万来见别见的希望，为什么那么？看着车队的驾驶者把那那么多数量他们下班的，对外开了，他们特别了那么多国内对接难度，普通话给我蛮多中文的，关键驾驶者老难不了手。Close friends who have long been together will separate. Wealth and possessions gained with much effort will be left behind. Consciousness, a guest, will leave the hotel of the body. To give up the concerns of this life is the practice of a bodhisattva. So this is the verse that we will be contemplating today and in the course of this week. So what this means, the first line is it says, close friends who have long been together will separate. So this is something that we need to understand. First thing we need to understand is because usually we have lots of attachment to sentient beings. And because we have this strong attachment, when we of course, you know, we gather together, family members and friends gather together, but when eventually, because it is impermanent, we have to separate. So like on the New Year's holidays, family and friends gather together. It's a very happy occasion, but then we have to separate when the holidays are over. And it's something similar to that in other occasions. And when that happens, there's a lot of suffering. There's suffering, you feel very lonely, you miss your friends, being with your friends and close ones. And that is because you have attachment. So if we understand, and this also comes as a surprise too, because we don't really think of the part where we separate. We usually look forward to the part where we will gather, but we wish that we will not separate. And we don't really come to accept the fact that it is natural for us, for there to be separation. So then when the separation actually happens, occurs, then we suffer. So if we understand that it is natural for there to be separation, then there will not be much suffering.
第一个偈颂里面就是说，常伴亲友各分离，也就是说，我们因为对自己的亲友有非常多的执着，这样子的话，我们在聚在一起的时候就会觉得非常的开心，但是由于无常，最终都是会分开的。举例来说，比如说新年和亲朋好友聚在一起的话，确实是觉得非常的开心，可最后总会要有分开，分开的时候就会有许许多多的痛苦，因为和家人的和亲朋好友的分开，你会因此而感到痛苦，会非常思念自己的亲朋好友。因为我们有非常强烈的执着，这一点是我们通常都不怎么去思维的，因为我们都非常盼望和亲友聚在一起，不认为分开是正常的。但其实分开，由于无常而分开，确实是非常正常的一件事情。 所以说，我们如果有这样子的政见的话，认为因为无常而导致分开的话是正常的话，那我们也就不会因此而产生执着的心，也就不会有痛苦。
And then, wealth and possessions gained with much effort will be left behind. So what that means is that usually, we all work very hard to accumulate wealth and possessions. And we accumulate it in hopes that we will attain it, and we will be able to keep it almost as if forever. But the reality is that once we attain it, the wealth and possessions will slowly waste. It will lessen eventually, gradually, and in the end, we will lose it. Either it will be stolen by others, it will or if not taken away by others, like at the time of death, or before that, we will have to divide it with family members and share it. And then when we die, of course, we cannot take it with us. So in the end, either way, we lose it. We lose all the wealth and possessions that we accumulated with much effort. But we usually don't think of that. We just think of the part where we work hard to accumulate it and keep it as if we can forever. That's the part where we usually think what we usually think about in most cases. So, and because of that, when the time comes when we suddenly part from our wealth, then great suffering occurs because we do not see that coming, or we do not think of it, or we do not accept it as being natural for that to happen in life. So, as a bodhisattva, it's important to also understand that whatever wealth and possessions you accumulate, it will be left behind in the end. So, therefore, it is not worth to be attached to wealth and possessions. Not just is it not worth to be attached to close friends, as mentioned in the first line, but also in the second line, the bodhisattvas should not be attached to wealth and possessions because both are impermanent.
第二个偈颂说，情积之财留后世，这个就是说，我们平时都会因为都会非常努力的去积累我们的财富，因为我们会希望通过我们积累的财富能够永久的保存我们的财富。可是现实当中的话，我们得到的财富总会因为各种的原因而慢慢的减少，最后我们会失去我们的财富，不管是有可能会被别人夺走。或者是说，我们最后会分给我们的亲朋好友，分给我们的家人；又或者是我们死了之后的话，肯定是带不走一分一毫。但平时我们这些都是不会去思维的，我们平时努力的工作都是为了努力的能够积累我们的财富，因为我们想着这些财富总是能够永久保存。可是如果死亡突然降临的时候的话，我们就带不走我们的财富，因为这一点就会产生很多的痛苦，而且不单可是这个观念，却是生活当中就非常正常的一部分，只不过我们平时不会去这样子想而已。所有的财富，我们所累积的财富的话，都会留给后世，而不能够永久的保存。同样的，就好像第一个偈颂当中我们所说的，我们对朋友的执着，包括第二个偈颂里面所讲的对积累财富的执着的话，都是错误的观念，因为一切都是无常的，这一切都是留不住的。
The third line says, consciousness, a guest, will leave the hotel of the body. So what this is trying to show is that the body is just impermanent. The body is not yours forever.
第三个偈颂"时刻钟离深刻殿"的意思就是说，我们的肉体、我们的身体也是无常的，我们的身体也是不属于我们自己的。
Because, we should understand from the example of the hotel and the guest. So, for example, think about a traveler who's traveling, and the path is long, the journey is long, I guess I'm saying, the journey is long, and it's becoming night. So the traveler needs to stay for the night somewhere for the night, and there's a hotel on the road. So the traveler will enter the hotel, book a room, and stay there for however many days the traveler wishes to rest, and during that time, the traveler has become the guest of the hotel, living in the hotel. But the hotel is not the traveler or the guest's permanent home. It's just a temporary place to stay and rest. Eventually, the guest needs to leave the hotel, check out of his or her room, leave the hotel, and move on their journey. And so likewise, that's similar to our situation. Currently, our consciousness has taken possession of our body. And this is similar to the guest taking shelter in the hotel. It may be for some a period of time. Likewise, the consciousness will take possession of this body for a number of years. There's no limit, there's no certainty to how many years. You could be born soon, you could die soon after you are born. You could live to the age of 5, 10, 20, or 50, or 100, or a little over 100, but eventually you'll die. So that is the case. And after we die, then the consciousness will leave the body, will part from the body, and will find a new body to take possession of. So that is similar.
这里举了个例子，就是说，就像我们的，就是我们的意识和我们的身体，就好像旅客和一个酒店之间的关系一样，因为旅途非常的漫长，一个旅客他在这个漫长的旅途当中，他就会找一个寄宿的地方去入住，但是他就在他入住之后就变成了这一个酒店的客人，但是他并不会把这个酒店当做自己真正的家，只是一个暂时居住的地方。同样的，也就是说我们的意识的话，也就是暂时的居住在我们的这样的一个身体里面，就好像这个旅客他暂时住在这个酒店里面一样。具体来说，我们这个神识，住在我们这个身体里面的时间，的长短是不确定的，有可能短，有可能长，但是总有这个神识会离开我们的身体。我们当我们的这个肉身，无常的，或者说我们死去的时候的话，这个神识就会离开我们的身体，找到一个新的身体。
So basically, this is saying that not only should the bodhisattvas not have strong attachment or have strong concerns about close friends, wealth, and possessions, but also they should not have strong attachment to their body.
所以我们作为修行人的话来说，不仅仅是不能过分的担心，或者是说执着我们的朋友和我们的财富，对我们身体来说也是一样的。
Because as I mentioned, it's just temporary. You're just looking after your body. You're taking possession of your body temporarily. Eventually, your consciousness will part from your body. So that is why.
因为我们的肉身也是暂时的，也是刹那，也是刹那，也是无常的。总有一天，我们的神识会离开我们的身体。
This also shows indirectly that, of course, you know, as Buddhists, we speak of the precious human life. We need to look after our body. We need to take care of it. But then that doesn't mean we should be focused solely upon the body, too focused on the body, too attached to the body. It shows here that the progress of the mind is more important than that of the body.
从另一个角度，或者说从侧面来讲的话，佛教徒总说侠满难得，或者说人生难得，但是这个也不代表我们应该去尊重我们这个人生，我们应该去重视的是我们的意识的一种进步，或者说我们意识的一种提升。
So of course we can take care of our body and use makeup and perfumes and take good care of it like that. But then some people go to the extreme of maybe like body modifications and just like so focused on the body, which is of course those people who do that are mostly not spiritual practitioners, but for Buddhists, then those are really unnecessary to do that. So therefore, what is most important is to make modifications to the mind, not the body.
当然，我们为了照顾我们的身体的话，我们会想各种各样的办法，不管是照顾身体啊，或者是我们去化妆，或者是使用香水等等，甚至有一些比较极端的人会去选择整容，但通常这一些都不是就是走极端，通过整容的方法来照顾身体的话，通常都不是有信仰的人所做出来的，更加不会说是佛教徒。佛教徒要重视的是我们的意识或者是我们的心智上的整容改变，而不是说去改变或者说去整容我们的身体。
Lastly, it says to give up the concerns of this life, attachment to close friends, wealth, and possessions, to the body. Those are all concerns of this life. Most people who are attached to close friends and the above mentioned do not really think of the future lives that much. They are more focused on this life. Because when you're accumulating wealth and possessions, it's like, you're thinking of this life. You're not thinking that I'm accumulating wealth and possessions for my next life, because the wealth and possessions that you accumulate in this life will not be very beneficial for the next life. And also, the close friends mentioned here are close friends that we have in this life. We don't know who our close friends will be in our next life. So, and also, the body is the body of this life, not the future life. So, all of this are present life related things that we are attached to. So these are things that we should not be too attached to, and we should not be too concerned of. And that is the practice of a bodhisattva.
所以说舍弃是今生佛子行，也就是说我们应该放弃对朋友、对财富以及对我们身体的执着。之所以我们会有对朋友、对财富或者是对身体强烈的执着的话，通常是因为我们没有思维来世的缘故。通常我们之所以会执着我们眼前的朋友、财富以及我们的身体的话，都是因为我们的思维局限于这一生，我们从来没有考虑过来世，因为我们现在所执着的这些朋友啊、财富以及身体，都是指这一生的，这些执着都是对来世无益的。就比如说，我们现在执着的朋友，我们却不知道我们来世的朋友会是谁；我们执着的财富也只是对今生受益，没有办法带到来世；我们的肉身也是无常的，也没办法带到来世。所以，我们应该放弃对这些的执着。
So the main lesson to understand from this verse is that bodhisattvas should not be attached to this life.
所以这里我们就是要明白，作为佛教徒的话，就不应该对今生有执着的心。
We have a very important mind training practice in our Sakyapa tradition called parting from the four attachments, which was taught by Aryamanjushri to the third Sakya teacher, Sachin Kongguan Ningpo, when he was 12 years old. And Aryamanjushri told him, it's just one verse, four lines, one verse, very short, but it includes the whole path of the Mahayana, the perfection vehicle, Sutrayana. So in the first line, Manjushri said to Sachin Kongguan Ningpo, the third Sakya teacher, if you are attached to this life, you are not a Dharma practitioner.
这里非常重要的就是说，我们要明白，就是我们要远离对今生的执着。在萨迦派里面有一个非常重要的一个心识的一个训练，就是依靠一个文殊菩萨对四时贡嘎宁波所讲授的一个偈颂，就是萨迦里斯坦法。这个短短的四句偈颂里面就包含了大乘佛教显宗的一切的精华。这里面第一句里面就是说贪着今生非行者。
So, if you are attached to this life, you are not a Dharma practitioner. You do not become a Dharma practitioner. If you are attached, we do many practices, like generosity and the like of the Bodhisattva practices. But if you are just doing it for fame in this lifetime, for to attain qualities or benefits in just in this lifetime, if you're just concerned about this lifetime, then whatever practice you do does not become Mahayana practice. It doesn't even become Hinayana practice either. It is not Dharma practice. It is not a Buddhist practice if you do that. So, is what if, this is something we need to look out for, because at times we do the practices very carefully, but the motivation ends up getting mixed up with, you know, concerned about this life and this life alone. So we need to be careful, because if that happens, then whatever we're doing is not becoming Dharma practice. And if it does not become Dharma practice, there will be no, we will not enjoy attaining any of the results, which is Buddhahood, or not even, even if you are a Hinayana practitioner, you will not even attain Arahathood if you are attached to this life.
你就是说，如果我们对今生还有执着的话，我们就算是行持虚行多多的善法，比如说行持布施等等，但是如果说我们在行持布施的时候的话，是为了得到今生的名闻利养的话，或者是那这样就是不是说以不执着今生的这样的一个动机去行持的话，那不管我们做什么都不是佛教，不管是大乘也好，还是小乘也好，就是说我们就算有可能我们在行善的时候，我们的行为非常的仔细，或者说我们做的事情非常的仔细，但是我们的发心有可能在我们的行善的时候就会混淆，就有可能一不当心就会变成了只是为了获得今生的名闻利养而去行持，那这样子的话，我们不管行什么样的善，都不是佛教，都不会想到所谓的果报，这个果报不管是说大乘的佛果也好，还是小乘的阿罗汉的果位也好。
You can do Dharma practice for the sake of this life and future lifetimes. It can be for this lifetime along with doing it for future lifetimes, but it cannot be for this life alone, for the sake of this life alone. So it has to go with doing it for the future as well. But between doing it for this lifetime and the future, it should be mainly for the future, which means the next life and the lives after that.
我们在行持佛教里面的一切的善的时候，我们可以为了我们今生的利益而考虑，但是我们更重要的是要把重点放在未来世的考虑上，也就是说我们在行善的时候，确实是可以考虑今生，但是我们的重点或者说我们的最主要的目标是为了来世而考虑，不只是来世，而且包括未来的一切转世，重点要放在来世而考虑，而不是为了今生而考虑。
To further sort of illustrate this, there's a Kadamba story, an actual incident in the past. So it happened at Rajing Monastery. So Rajing Monastery is like the base monastery of the Kadamba tradition in Tibet.
这里再详细来说的话，我们要举一个噶当派的一个公案。
The monastery is this name. And so the monastery belonged to Jomdenpa. So Jomdenpa is a lay person, a lay master. He was the disciple of Atisha.
这里我们所说的这个噶当派的公案是发生在一个叫热真寺的一个寺庙里面，然后是关于一个叫尊登巴尊者的一个公案，他是，sorry, he's a lay practitioner of
Kadamba, so Kadamba tradition in Tibet. So Dromdenpa is the disciple of Atisha, and he, Dromdenpa, built Rajing Monastery. So Rajing Monastery became like the first monastery of the Kadamba tradition.
我们这个所讲的公案就是发生在热真寺，就是尊登巴尊者，他也就是阿地侠尊者的弟子，然后他是建立噶当派热真寺的创始人。
Dromdenpa himself was not a monk. He was a lay person, but he was an emanation of Avalokiteshvara.
尊登巴尊者他本身不是出家人，是在家人，但他是观世音菩萨的转世。
Anyways, there was a monk at Rajing Monastery. Because it was a monastery, there were many monks. And there was one monk who was doing a lot of circumambulations around the monastery. A lot of what we would call gora in Tibetan, but circumambulations going around the monastery clockwise. So he was doing that. And then Dromdenpa came to him and said, you're doing a lot of circumambulations around the monastery. That is very good. But wouldn't it be better if you actually did some Dharma practice? So he told that to the monk.
在这个寺院当中，有许多的出家人，他其中有一个出家人，他就一直是在绕这个寺庙所，就是在这个寺庙就绕塔。当时中德巴跟他说：“你这样子绕塔确实是非常的好，但是为什么不去修一些具体的佛法？”
And then the monk thought, oh, then maybe I should read the Mahayana Sutras. So then he started reading the textbooks, the Mahayana Sutras, for a long time. And then Dzogchen Bar again came to him and said, "You're reading. I see that you're reading the Mahayana Sutras, the textbooks, the holy scriptures. That is very good. But shouldn't you be doing Dharma practice?"
所以当时那个僧众就想，他应该要去念诵许多的经文，于是他就去念诵了许许多多的大乘佛教的经典。中南巴尊者在看到了之后，又跟这位僧众说：“你这样子念诵确实是很好，可是你不应该行持佛法吗？”
And then he thought, oh, so maybe Dharma practice means meditating. So then he went to do meditation. He meditated and meditated, the monk meditated. And then Dzogchen Bar again came to him and said, "I see that you're doing meditation. That's very good. But shouldn't you be doing Dharma practice?"
于是这个僧众就想，那他应该去修，应该去打坐，去修禅定。于是他就去打坐。中南巴尊者在看到了之后说：“我看到你在打坐，在修禅定，非常的好。可是你不应该行持佛法吗？”
And then the monk became very confused. He thought, well, Dzogchen Bar keeps telling me that I should do Dharma practice, but it seems circumambulating the monastery is not, it doesn't seem to be a true Dharma practice. And then reading the scriptures isn't that either. And same for meditating. So what is Dharma practice? He asked himself and he got quite confused. So he asked Dzogchen Bar finally, how should I do Dharma practice then? What is Dharma practice? And then Dzogchen Bar replied to him, "Do not be attached to this life. Do not be attached to this life." He said it twice to him in reply.
这个僧众就想，每一次他不管行持什么的时候，中南巴尊者都问他：“你不应该，你不是应该去行持佛法吗？”他想，我之前不管是转塔，还是念诵大乘佛教经典，还是修禅定，中南巴尊者都这样子问我。于是他就去问中南巴尊者，到底什么才是修持佛法？于是中南巴尊者就和他说了3遍：“不要执着于今生。”
So that is what we need to keep in mind.
所以这个就是我们要记住的这一点。好，我们今天讲到这里。
大家有问题的话，可以把问题打在那个对话框里面。If anyone have question, you can type your question at the text box.
So there's a question that wonders, since modern individuals, they're always occupied about thinking about this life or not, and how can one break the thought of this as he or she felt very touched about the idea of not being attached to this life, which you have just mentioned.
So how to be less concerned about this life, is that the question?
Yes, how to not have thoughts always being occupied thinking about this life.
That is the answer to that would be to think about impermanence, the impermanent nature of what we are attached to in this life. So of course we have this attachment to this life. It is either to wealth or possessions or people. So we just need to think of the impermanent nature of all of them. And then if we think of the impermanent nature of them, then we will the attachment to that will slowly sort of weaken.
这个问题就是问说，现在人不间断的杂念都是关于今生的，怎么样打破这一点？房子的回答就是说，我们要去思维无常，比如说我们现在所执着的东西，不管是朋友也好，还是财富也好，他们的本质其实他们的本质都是无常的。所以说，我们这样子去思考的话，就能够慢慢减少我们对今生的这一些执着。
The preliminary practices are very good for that, such as the, so we have four mainly, as you know, the precious human life, the impermanence, cause and effect, and the faults of samsara. So in order to to get rid of that attachment to this life, these are very strong, mainly the impermanence, the impermanent nature of life, that meditating, contemplating on that, as well as contemplating and reflecting upon the faults of samsara. So if we can contemplate like that, then it will lessen our attachment to this life.
嘉行也是非常的好，比如说四嘉行里面的人生难得、寿命无常、因果不续以及轮回过患的话，修持这些嘉行能够帮助我们远离对今生的执着。其中，修持寿命无常以及轮回过患的话，特别能够使我们放弃对今生的执着。There's also a question that wonders if we don't live well this life, the negativity of this lifetime will carry on to the next lifetime. How do we balance this?
So if we don't live well in this life, well, probably means like, I guess the idea is that if we don't do a lot of good in this lifetime, but instead do a lot of bad or misdeeds, accumulate misdeeds, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, so if you do that, of course, then as I mentioned earlier, there are three different types of ways that results are born from causes. One is the cause, which is you accumulate the cause in this lifetime, the result occurs in this very lifetime. The second type is you accumulate the cause in this lifetime, the result occurs in the next, very next lifetime. The third type is you accumulate the cause in this lifetime, the result occurs in the lifetime after the night, in the lifetimes following the next lifetime, the very next lifetime. So yes, it will continue in the following lifetimes if you don't accumulate good deeds in this lifetime, if you don't live well.
这个问题就是说，我们如果这一生没有修好，或者是我们没有积累足够的善业的话，那我们这些恶果是不是会会在来世受到果报？房子说我们之前讲过，因果的三个受报的时间，一个是今生报，一个是来世报，一个是顺后世报，就是不是来世，而是之后的那一世受报。所以是的，如果说我们这一生当中没有行持足够的善业，没有修好的话，确实这些恶也会在以后世受到果报。
There's a saying by Guru Rinpoche, if you want to know your past life, look at your present situation. If you want to know your future situation or lives, look at your present situation. So this has a deep meaning, because if you want to know what your past lives were, like if you want to know if you had a good past life, then look at your present situation. If you're living well right now with happiness and the like, that means you lived a good life, you lived your life wisely in your past lifetimes. If you want to know if you'll experience happiness, if you live a good life in your future, or if you'll experience and live a miserable life in your future lives, just look at your current situation. How are you living life, your life presently? If you're living it well, then that means in your future lifetimes, it is most likely that you will experience a happy lifetime. If you're accumulating bad right now, then bad deeds, then it means in the future you will experience a miserable life.
这里就莲花生大师之前讲过一个偈颂，就是说，就是说，具体的偈颂我有点忘记，不好意思。但是就是说，如果，我们能够通过我们的今生，能够看到我们以前来世，以前我们过去世所行的善业，然后若想两知后世， 若想了知后世果的话，就要看我们今生所行持的善业或者是恶业。那也就是说，我们这一生当中过得好或者是不好，都是因为我们以前所行持的善或者所行持的恶。那如果说我们这一生当中所行持的善和行持的恶的话，也能够决定我们来世过的是好还是不好。这里补充一下，莲花生大师所说的偈颂是：若知前世因，今生受者是；若知后世果，今生作者是。So I'm just trying to find out the actual phrases that was mentioned by Guru Rinpoche.
哦，好。마 남가다 냐베 심제 탐제 라마 상게 레보 쳬라 갸브소 쳬 상게 쳬다 겐데 남라 갸브소 쳬 라마 예담 칸제 쳬라 갸브소 쳬 랑셈 동사 쳬게 굴라 갸브소 쳬 마 남가다 냐베 심제 탐제 라마 상게 레보 쳬라 갸브소 쳬 상게 최다 겐데 숨나 갑소 쳬 라마 예담 칸저 초라 갑소 쳬 라셈 동사 취게 굴라 갑소 쳬 오마 나카다 냐데 셈제 담체 라마 상게 렘보 쳬라 갑소 쳬 상게 최다 겐데 남라 갑소 쳬 라마 예담 칸저 초라 갑소 쳬 라셈 동사 취게 굴라 갸브스 치오 와마네 베메 후 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 어머니 뱀에 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 어
Dedan lobru kendi gürbay dedan nedan cümde tevaso semce yeme devene nam cide kamzo cumara ma göç çedala şeme çibe secaşin gece çiba lüsem talçe sonca nege dumala cinye ba cide kamzo cumara ma göç Çıda şince kanan çıba dara nege minzam tebe taçep. Nince badan taberim soge lüce gülane bara makruç. Ebe geri donca gecu da lobro yeco sümge çuçu. Şige zaşı nela sobayı lüce gülla cevra makruç. Lüzem deva malı çoce be cunşi çube dungla çinye. Malü şişen dando demba dan seri neme degi dembaş. Lama günşo sümge tuce dan kancı çügyo sümme nüdü. Nence luva mebe dendo oa melam dabze cubala şu. Lama yidam sangye changsem so kyab yulo rangcham gyatze choche Zeche donwe yangye solde na yela membe tunde nyutruz Kera ngage wangbe yalme da gune kawa duja gave So nama bado chenpa la ye da chen jeda shabla so wad Nyeri jidu jekyang gyume karakazan jidu gyurwa mozras. Mije jiden kamge rulwa le deme shiba dine chiyet. Tena lari da karazama la kenze libe ve karatsu son. Zeche denbe gume gyungge ba kundun shenu taryan nyurjens. Tsagyu lama nangye chenla da nangyu rinna jubye dentoy. Denbe nga da baden sakyam luzan gele chojuru kyab gyuru chi. Baden tsawe lama rinpo che dage che wara beme den shuwa. Kadin chenpe gwenye jeson de kuson tukye mwen chum tzadu so. Chime me jeson be gulkana, chime tse jen la mo chen de ma, chime tse la wang be tso nam gi. Chime tse ye ngu zhu za du son, shi son be me tu ge la la ne, ken tse nu de rang su ni mura che, sa de lung do be ca ge tse ne, du lu ja lin shi gun du da de son, na wang gyu zhu la shi kun ge tong, Chogin ga zhe te chen do nga lam, pe de ba du ba ra ve chen le chen, san pe wang ye gya bu, shab de so nam da chim de sri ki, sa shi la te sama guan de ri chen, du lu ma zhe che zhe zom da je de, Pan rin ge gyab cho re wang le pur ten shu so gyab wang ni ba je zun kong ma nye gyab den chi du nye gyu tse ma shi gyab lam san sa mo lop shi nam ma gyab wang chi shi de zi sha den su lo pu tso gyab si du gyu Sha shi ba ba de sa ge chu si Ba la ba la ne ne cho zam ne zi pe Ken du chun chun shen san sun tu chen Ta de su lu me la ma chun sun Tu je dang yi dam de sun kya zi Tu dhava dhan chi nye sa mo gyurai me Tenbe tu chi dhala so be tu Ten chu gyurai chi
Chi me wang bo nya wa ཁྱི Tien du kuen gan ji bi nam ji ji Tho mi khan du ji li du ru ji yi Si sum wan gyur chi bu shab di shu
Namo diye tam cesi pa Nye to me nye be jana pa cene Ke gai na je ba lon chu ba Ye se be to le jo ba jo ba Chom chamba bawe chedarai kemba Dain gendu zambu te ya te shen de Tendai gengi jesu dana Chingi wan de da tam che ram du mo tu sumo she be gya wa tam che ge ngo wa ka la cho do e nga ba de da ge ge be ca wa de ge gya Sambo je chera doe mo varai ki Chancho gyove gyo bai cho gyuru Bai ki ju gya tsu yong su kawe ne Kari chudri Dēmbā sādze, bāi sāgyā bāyē, dēmbā kī gyūrūjī. Kāngjēn pēkī dēvarāi dhūrūjī, dēmbā dē sāgyī, chūsī bāra gyūrūjī. Chūpē dōngi gīnchē mē pā Tāng gīngyāng chēndē nāng kā nyāng bālā shō. Thank you. We'll see you next week. No, 2 weeks later.